is pollinated. And then this is good for that question about what would be different in your breakfast, or what honeybee products do you use, if you're talking to the public about that. $14 billion of agricultural crops that are indirectly benefit from honeybees. So things like dairy and beef, because the cattle are being fed grains that are pollinated by honeybees. So that's something to keep in mind. You can tell somebody, well, what your breakfast look like. You can take away the sausage, you can take away the jelly, you can take away the toast, all sorts of things that are indirectly or directly pollinated by bees. And the pollination services economy is a large one. It's $46 million. Africanized honeybees is something that you'll frequently get asked about by the public. Africanized honeybees, it's kind of an interesting story. Africanized honeybees were first introduced, the species of honeybee was first introduced by a researcher named Warwick Kerr into Brazil intentionally. And this species was interbred with European honeybees to form a subspecies. So an Africanized honeybee is not a different species of bee. It's also Apis mellifera, but it's a subspecies of Apis mellifera. And they're actually very difficult to distinguish from normal Apis mellifera. You have to do, there's all these morphometrics of ratio of the wing span to the body length and things like that, but just looking at them with the naked eye, people can't really tell them apart very easily. And what happened was these interbred honeybees then escaped from the facility of where Warwick Kerr was doing his research in Brazil. And so now they've spread gradually up through North America and other parts of the world, down into South America and all over. And the main thing is that they differ in both their defensive behavior. So they tend to sting more readily. They tend to sting in mass. But they're also differ in their hardiness. And this was part of the interest in these bees, was that they tend to, if there's parasites in the hive, they tend to react to those parasites, whereas we've domesticated the European honeybee so much that they often don't react well to the parasites. They don't chase them out of the hive or deal with them. They don't groom each other as rigorously in defense against the parasites. And so even though Africanized honeybees are a bad thing in a lot of ways, because a honeybee keeper who has them has to deal with the fact that the bees are more aggressive, so they'd have to suit up more rigorously. They have to deal with, in the US, lawsuits potentially against people getting stung by these bees. One of the plus sides is that they are more hardy sometimes from diseases that we see. So some beekeepers in some parts of the world who just, there's no hope in not having these, have just given up and that they keep these bees. And it's possible, it's just a little more of a hassle. And some of those diseases, I won't go into all of these, but there are all sorts of diseases that affect either the larvae or the adults in a honeybee hive. There's bacterial diseases, there are fungal diseases, there are viruses. And so here are some of the different ones that you'll see. There's also parasites of the hive. There's tracheal mites, so mites that actually get into the respiratory system of the bees. The number one disease of honeybees historically has been the varroa mite. This is a large mite that hangs out on the bees. You can see them with your naked eye. And they'll actually suck on the hemolymph for the blood, the equivalent of blood that the bee has. And then things like greater wax moth and small hive beetle. This is a chart of the life cycle of the small hive beetle. And the problem with things like greater wax moth and small hive beetle is they'll hang out in the hive and they'll mess up the hive. Honeybees are very clean in that they always leave the hive to defecate. So they don't have any part of the hive where they defecate, for instance. But these animals will be in the hive, they'll be eating the honey, they'll be defecating, and that sets up fermentation in the honey, and it makes the hive unclean. And so that's one of the big problems with those sorts of parasites. And then probably one of the most frequent things you're going to be asked about if you're hanging out at the bee station here and talking to the public will be colony collapse disorder. And what colony collapse disorder is this is this new problem with honeybees that's in the news an awful lot lately. It first appeared in 2006, and millions of hives have been lost worldwide to it. Some beekeepers have lost 80, 90% of their colonies. And they're not really the latest news on it. There have been all different things. This was the one that maybe you heard people were saying the cell phones were possibly causing it. The bees will leave the hive and they'll disappear, and they won't find the bees, and they won't return to the hive. And there were all sorts of theories that were put out, such as cell phone frequencies were confusing the bees and their navigation and preventing the bees from being able to come back to the hive. That's been proven not to be the case. And the latest news looks like it's a combination of a virus called the Israeli virus, which was first discovered in Israel. Some of the colonies that collapse have that, some of them don't. So it's not always associated with it. Exposure to chemicals is also believed to be a contributing factor. Right around this time in 2006, a new group of insecticides were being introduced in the United States, and these are called neonicotinoids. Nicotine, as well as caffeine and several other chemicals that we use from plants, were actually evolved by plants as insecticides. And so neonicotinoids, basically, they are synthetic nicotines, or they mimic nicotines, or the effects of nicotines on insects. And so these are a new group of insecticides that are being sprayed on crops. And so some people have said, well, maybe that has a role in it. And then parasites and diseases. So honeybees are really stressed these days. They're in an environment that's often polluted. They're transported long distances, although the article does point out that bees that were transported and bees that stayed stationary, there wasn't a noticeable difference in colony collapse for those. So they think that it's just all these things on top of each other at this point is the best guess. But there's no one thing. And one of the problems is for things like the Israeli virus, insects don't have learned immunity. They have just innate immunity. And so you can't vaccinate an insect against a disease. They don't create antibodies in their immune system like we do. And then nutrition may also play a role. If bees are being put on one crop for the whole season, then they're getting only the pollen of, let's say, almonds, for instance. And they're not getting a varied diet. And so that's another possible. So basically, the news right now is that we're not sure, and all of these things are being put out as possibly having a cumulative effect on the bees. So lastly, how do you use all this when you're presenting bees here? So now you have a whole bunch of information about bees that you can talk to the public about. And remember a few things when you talk to the public about bees. And this also has to do with insects, too, in general. People have a connection to bees. They have a connection through honey. A lot of people like honey. I rarely meet somebody who says, oh, I don't like honey at all. Through pollination, so you can point out all those crops, all the things that you use every day that are directly or indirectly attributed to honeybee pollination. And through sociality, we love it when we see things that parallel ourselves and our culture and our society and the animal world. And we love kind of making that connection of, wow, bees help each other out. Wow, they have these big societies. They live in these hives that look like cities. We love imagining things like that and having that connection. People are also fascinated by things they're afraid of. So if people are afraid of bees, it's like this. You always see with animals that people are afraid of. They go, oh, gosh, and then they want to kind of get closer, and then they have this fascination. So that can be used to your advantage. The observation hive is a great place to show behavior, to show the different castes. I'm pretty sure pretty soon we'll get drones in there, and so that's really fun to show people. And we can go up there and see the dance going on. And then reproduction, you can show them the workers that are feeding the larvae. You can show them the cells that are covered up that have pupae in them. You can sometimes see adults emerging from the cells that have pupated. And then you can get their interest with astonishing bee facts. So that first question I had on that first slide about what animal doesn't have a father but has a grandfather. Does anybody know the answer to that now? The drone. Yeah. So that's a great, I mean, you know, you ask somebody that question out of the blue and they go, that's impossible. And then you can explain that to them.